I wish you would see me as I'm not a spiritual leader in any case. I'm a mechanic. I consider myself a mechanic. I'm a transmission specialist of a sort. I'm working on transmission of key, of intention. And I'm heir to a legacy that comes down from many generations regarding point or presence or center. And through me, through my touch, comes the touch of the founder of Aikido. And Aikido is not passed on. There is no Bible that you can buy that says this is what Aikido is, and no definition of it. It's an art that's transmitted from person to person. These vibrations pass among us. And I think that the vibrations that have come down here will, I hope, help you in your conflicts and help you to help other people in theirs. There's too much dawdling going on. There's too much, you know, physical or psychological primping. Before you get it on. And real life is not that way, right? Real interaction between people, you don't have that leisure, you don't have that time, you have that space, especially the space, especially if you go to a city. And how often, here, let's go out and do an Aikido thing together, okay? The normal Aikido thing is, right? And we start from here, right? When do you ever deal with another human being, except perhaps a used car salesman, across a car at this distance? No, never. And especially when the pressure heats up and somebody gets in your face, no, you're not allowed to move. You're not allowed to move. Because why should you move just because I get in your face? Or vice versa. And if we're serious about something, it'll draw us in. And if I'm freaking out or whatever, I'll be talking at you. You'd be lucky if there's this much space between us. Okay, so how do we deal? How does Aikido work in that? Let's get out of the comfort zone. Let's start dealing a little bit with reality. Okay? So what happens is we get out here and we psychologically or physically primp and we, you know, do that and all that stuff, right? And what happens is our mind is working about, geez, what did I leave in the fridge? Did I leave the gas on, you know? What are you doing later tonight? Whatever. There's all this garbage going on in there that is our enemy right now. Right now, the official stated goal of Aikido, or one of them, is action without thought. No thought. No psychology. Simple, appropriate movement. Because if you think you can move appropriately in daily life, especially in some sort of physical confrontation in daily life, you know, with thought, you can't. If somebody was really in your face, the last thing you would do would be thinking. You know? You'd be right there and you'd be wherever, you'd be going through whatever you're going through, but you would be there. So let's simulate that now. And let's up the pressure, let's turn the heat up. Certainly now, right this moment, in terms of speed. Let us not be dilatory in getting up. Let's go right back in, grab a hold, and do whatever technique we're doing. In this case, it's Kokunage. And come right back, make sure the other person is uninjured and isn't landed on by somebody else. Take care of them, come right back. Don't lose their sight of them or feeling of them for a split second. When you get up, there's a tendency to go like that, to adjust your gi. It's more than simple vanity. It's taking a break, cooling out, getting back and off the intensity. Keep the fire up. Keep right on the case. All right? So please do that. Thank you. Okay, what does that signify hung out there? You're going to dry laundry on that sucker? What? when he comes up, then if you want, make it part of a movement that's not automatic, that it should be out there, and you know that. Yeah, looking good, you guys. Look, that's who you got to work. Yes, you did, and you looked.
Me?
Yeah, and it's nothing. We all have it. Okay, all right. This is where we get to practice on this letting go of that. Okay, because if we use power and strength, force to do this, then we'll get into that. That'll bring us. Our muscles will bring us back into that, because it's like every other hard endeavor that you try. This is an easy endeavor, and you must let go of it, and it's very difficult to do. You never looked where he was looking. You never came into agreement. Fast. Okay. Thank God he was there. He saved you from falling. Or she did. Okay, now. This is, look where you are.
Yeah, that's way off.
The width of your feet limits you. It makes you strong in this forward dimension, but it makes you tremendously vulnerable to the side. Next time you're washing the dishes, brushing your teeth, reading in a bookstore, what have you, look down and notice where your feet are. That's normal stance. That's what we want to get to in Aikido. It's a normal, natural way that you have evolved. That's the best thing for you. Then you'll be asked to bend your knees and make different kind of adjustments from them. But the start and returning point is always your normal, natural stance. Yeah. Okay, so... Okay, so that will make you do what you did not do then. What you did not do then was agree with him. You tried to dominate him. Okay, you tried to stick your arm across and force your will on him. Okay, so grab hold. Come on. Juice. Okay, so now, the harder he grabs, the easier it is for me. Okay, now I come in to look so that my eyes and his eyes, hopefully my feet and his feet, are in the same line, the same direction. That agreement is what the enemy or the opposition or the other person, it's the one thing they can't handle. More opposition, yeah, they can deal with it. But agreement, no. Agreement is the worst thing. And it doesn't have to be long and it doesn't have to be far, but it has to be total for a split second. And it's not that easy to do. Opposition they can handle. But suddenly, instead of presenting them with more opposition, you present them with agreement. It's devastating, absolutely devastating. And it's the germ, it's the soul of the art, this agreement. Is what happened here. That slight push in was agreeing with the force that held it. And what happens, of why, even though it's your hand and on both sides, why does this work? Because when we're agreed with, we naturally relax a little. We can't help it. You can't help it. So why not join it? Why not use it? So that being the case, I usually do the bit about Osensei, when he would call his ukes out, he would call them out like this. Well, that's way too unsubtle. Who did I call in? Yeah. Did you feel it? You liar. You did feel it. Didn't you feel it? You felt it and then said no. Right? I mean, you don't have to agree with me, but and I'm just jiving off you anyway. That's why you felt it. Because it's not a look. It's a tug. Okay, and it's a tug that goes about like that. And in that, he would give you all the information you needed. Come, hit me this way. And if you did not pick up on that, he'd sit you down for a week. He wouldn't call on you. And you'd feel like dog meat. You'd feel like Igor or something, you know? Like you were really very unsubtle. And this is how he trained his uchideshi in subtlety. So I will call you that way. And if you jump up and I haven't called you, I'll let you know. Okay? So, but don't be afraid. Just jump up if you think I called you. So you want to forget it or shall I move on? Okay, so no, I gave you a chance. I'm mean. Okay, so, all right, we're talking about non-resistance here. Okay, well, no, we're not talking about non-resistance. We're talking about non-resistance in the form of agreement. What does agreement mean? Ideally, agreement means this. Right, yeah, and it contains that component. It's agreeable, okay? You go from opposition into agreeable with nothing in between. And that agreeableness is manifest by, hopefully, every part of your body. Give me some resistance there. Okay, so my feet turn. And my feet turn so that they are parallel to, conjoint with, the direction of her feet. My eyes, her eyes. I'm seeking to see through her eyes, not in metaphor, not because I'm a good guy. Right now I'm talking purely technique. It has nothing to do with ethics. It's pure technique. The techniques of agreement are that full and total withdrawal of opposition at one moment happens on every level of the body, particularly the belly and the heart and the head. And the hand. And if all these move in unison, that should result. I hammered her down by giving her a little opposition to direct her in the direction I wanted to go. That was slightly less than the subtlety I should be able to manifest, which is simply as a person on a ladder who has leaned too far forward on the ladder or on the chair goes like this to regain the balance, or having gone too far backwards, comes forward to regain the balance. So she, having been resisted, throws herself back, not consciously, because this doesn't happen in a conscious level. The body knows it. Watch drunks walk along. They're protected from falling by this internal gyro that we have. That's what causes, ideally, that's what causes this person to fall. And it's a good thing it does. So knowing that, you don't have to force them. You can be in charge of directing them to an end that doesn't cause them injury, that protects them. So again, without beating it in the ground, total agreement. Look, turn your heart, your head, and your hands in exactly the same way as a person comes at you. There's a point of imbalance here that he subjects himself to. I don't put him in it, but his grip, his force makes him meet with those consequences. Okay. It seemed as though I did it, and I guess in that case I did a little bit. It's a very subtle thing, and it happens very fast. And you really, once you agreed with him, you're free. You do, but you can turn back almost by thinking about it, okay? Because it's his balance that's at issue. Once you agree with him, he's already out of control. The next question is, what do we do with that out of controlness? Do we let it go down? Do we throw it forward? Do we whatever? You never once looked where she's looking. Never once. Right. Okay, now. Faster. See that? That's her imbalance that's causing that. My God, you got a grip on you. It's great. No, that's great. Put it to me. Yeah, absolutely. I'll tell you, not many folks can grip like that. You a farm girl or something?
Yes.
That's where that comes from. Sensei said the strongest people are farmers and fishermen.
Fishermen?
Yeah. One reason, because, especially as kids, where are you from?
South.
Yeah. Working in cold weather, grip is a function of pain. That's why the death grip is such a thing. People who feel no pain grip very hard. And as a kid, you learn to carry cold things, hard things a long way, and you get used to pain in your... And that's why you can grip... I mean, you just put some real serious hurting on me, and not many people can do that. Did I bring some up? All right, hold on a sec. Stay where you are, please. Just kneel down. Just stay. All right. I want to tell you, it occurred to me when I walked in here tonight in the building, that never, when I was initially at Hombu Dojo, would anybody ever thought that Aikido would ever be done in a building so beautiful. You know? It was done in dark, cramped, musty, lousy smelling holes is what it was done in, right? Right? And the mats were worn and the straw was coming through. And once a year it'd be a big deal to get new mats, you know, at least some of the mats would be new. Here you guys have got, I mean, come on, you know, this is just wonderful, you know? It's one, this building, is, how many of these exist in the world? Very few. Where is such space devoted to this kind of activity? Very few. So we must really give thanks for this. And at the same time, not get used to being spoiled by it. Because these flat surfaces, these broad areas, give us an illusion, especially for those of us who do it for a while, get an illusion of competence and power and ability. Hey, man, I can do Aikido. I got going to these things. There, man, you know, they don't give them out to everybody, you know. You get to think that really means something, you know, and you're really good and all of that. Well, that's one of the things, this inflation, which is a word we can put on that feeling, is one of the things that you have to work against. The white belt people, the people who are just beginning, are working on learning the terminology and throws. People have been around a little bit more. What do they work on? Get to a point where you can do the throws pretty good. So what do? Hang it up? No, you start working with increased sincerity and working against this feeling of having achieved something. Yeah, achieved nothing yet. You know, you talk to do it 60 years, come talk to me. When I do it 60 years, I'll come and talk to you. I haven't achieved anything either. All right? So one of the things that you have to work on, and you have to, you know, up those of you who've been doing it for a while, certainly, you have to up the pressure or turn the heat up on time and space. We've worked a little bit on time. I've charged you to be faster. Most of you sunk back to the level that you're comfortable with. That's okay. If I was here every day, especially having a whip, I could change that over time. But this is a one-shot deal, so I'll just mention it. Now I'll mention space. We talked about the practical unreality of dealing with people at a distance, other than... Yes, you look like some martial person, sir. Have you been trained? Right? Okay. Right, this, by the way, is one of the things that the really experienced people want to work against is all that martial garbage. You know? Last thing you want to let anybody know is that you know anything. That's a good start, you know? And one way to do it is to start rounding your shoulders and not go into a deal like this. If you approach somebody in this position, what's going to happen? Huh? They'll kill you. Yeah, right. a fight will ensue because I am prepared for fighting. So, and I'm being a little bit mean on you and stuff, but bear with me. Okay? So, one of the things that we want to work on is working against this big martial dealness, this inflation, again, of knowledge, knowing. And you want to be able to present yourself in such a way that it appears that you have no knowledge. And in fact, you don't. So manifest this by taking the tension and urge to dominance out of your shoulders. Let that go. Let your shoulders round. You can do it sitting down, too. All of us have been told this is a good way to walk around. It's a good way to be. High and hard. Well, it doesn't work that way. Right? Especially not when you get old. You want to get soft and round. And you want to learn that it increases your power rather than diminishes it to do that in about 6 different dimensions. All right, so we're dealing, right? And yeah, we're dealing. And if he drops... What? What?
Breathing.
Breathing, all right. good. That's I find that very helpful, you know? Okay. So we're dealing, right? All right. So we're going to have to, you know, perhaps let us work on the assumption that we have no space, that we are pressured, that Shomen Uchi happens from here. It doesn't happen from 6 feet out where it's nice and comfortable and convenient and we can deal with it. And what happens if it's here? What happens if it's your friend and he's drunk and he's telling you he can drive home fine and you know if he gets behind the wheel of that car, somebody's going to get hurt and you're not going to stand for it. It's not going to happen. Okay? And what happens? Because he's your cousin, he knew you when you were like that and he thinks you're a putz anyway, he may well try Shomen Uchi on you, you know, if he knows what it is, right? And you may have to deal at this level, at this speed. What do? You do Shomen Uchi. You do Ikkyo. Let's do Ikkyo. Okay, forget breathing now. Just do it. Okay. Really, because the enemy is your thought. The enemy is what is your intellect. The enemy is what tells you, okay, you got to do this and that and the other. I think. I don't write the book on this stuff. But that's what I think, right? Okay, so now let's practice. Let's practice this pressure at this distance by moving in. And let's slap flies. Some of you may have been to the workshop on Saturday. Will know what I mean. Slapping flies is like that. No Ikkyo this time. Slap fly. Okay, try to do it without blinking. Try to do it. Come on. Yeah. Pretty soon you'll get to doing about something. Yeah, right. And if we did it for 15 minutes, we'd work something out, right? That suited both of us, right? Okay. All right. Try it. Go ahead. You'll love it. No. It's not slapping flies. That's kissing in Marin, or that's whatever they call it here. No, we're talking.
Heart.
What is all that? You get to be doing it. Yeah, right. Pretty soon you get tired of me doing it. You being gentle and me wailing. Yeah, all right. Now we're talking. That's congruence. Okay? Uh-huh. So that's what we're talking, right? Yeah, he gets the action, right? No! Okay, so it's about like that.
Are you going to tell us about what the essence of this is?
Essence? Oh, of this?
Yes.
You mean there's a reason? Okay, so why are we doing this? Somebody said, you will tell us why we're doing this, won't you? But... judging from the laughter, I don't think I need to. The reason is that after a while, this stuff, sudden, especially if you're in Aikido for a while, sudden movements to the face no longer cause the terror that they first did when you came in. You know, let's say, you know, when you came in, some of you may have come in quite recently, but over time you'll find that you can be, after, if we did this 15 minutes a day for 3 months, you could be writing poetry, you could be doing anything while this person is doing it, and looking right in their eyes, it wouldn't bother. You could be drawing a sketch of them while they do it. There's no need to get into a big production and a big fear and scare number just because somebody's waving 5 digits in your face. So what? Who cares? It may be required of you to take charge of a situation and to control a situation so that life may be saved, injury may be spared. A case in point, I use this a lot. A person at a party who leans over the grill and forgets that her hair is long, and her hair comes too close to the thing, and boom, all of a sudden her hair's on fire. Well, you think when your hair's on fire, you're going to be cool? You're going to be mellow? You're going to say, hey, I'm a Don, man. I got a black belt. No, when your hair's on fire, you're going to be like every other man, woman, and child on this planet. You're going to freak. Yeah, I'm going to go crazy. Like a little boy who, in a picnic, stumbles into a bee's nest, and the bees go right for his head and starts running around. You got to catch the kid, get the kid down, take the bees off, having to think about it. One time when I was a kid, a person at a dinner where I was had an epileptic fit. Everybody, including myself, froze. I'd never seen anything like it. I absolutely did not know what to do. And I was totally deranged, and everybody else was, except one, his girlfriend, who knew how to take care of him. But that's where most people will be, let's say, when somebody gets bees on or their hair's on fire or something happens. And you got to move in. You have to take charge of that situation, perhaps, without any hesitation. Some help to other people. And here is a gym. Here is a place. Here's a refinery where we can practice that. So practicing this speed and this determination and this absolute, what's the word I'm wanting? Well, put it this way. Samurai said that they were training people. Japanese hung out with, you know, the Japanese samurai system went on for about 800 years. It was a feudal system and much depended on keeping factions at war. Thousands of men, women and children, millions were slaughtered in this process. And those people developing warriors found that, and they looked at it as Japanese can, very, very assiduously and very circumspectly, and, you know, just trying to see what was important. And they came up with 3 qualities that you need in a human being to make a good warrior. 3 primary things that you need, and 3 primary things, furthermore, that you can develop to some extent. The quality of boldness was important. The ability to move in, that was considered extremely important. The quality of resourcefulness, the ability to change your mind, change direction, change tools, change approaches, change your mind. Resourcefulness, 2. And 3 was benevolence. If you did not have benevolence, if you did not have heart, you could not make the cut. Heart is critical in making a warrior. We have an art that promotes, generates, and refines these 3 qualities here. And what is standing in the way of our being more bold in our lives, more resourceful, and more benevolent is this, is our intellect and our way of distancing ourselves from our spontaneous feelings. I think that, for most people, and I definitely include myself, is one of certainly the first level of practicing Aikido. When you got that one all wired, fax me collect. I'll come and study with you, and we'll go on to the next one, because I'm lagging a little. All right, so let's work on boldness, let's work on resourcefulness, and let's work on benevolence. How do you do benevolence in the dojo? I love you. Doesn't cut it. because it's not real, because it's not benevolent. It has the outward appearance of being, but it's not really benevolent. Okay? How you can be benevolent, and I've seen it here a number of times tonight, is when you grab a hold, you know, the other way with the thumbs up. There you go. And when you throw somebody down, make sure, that's nice, thanks, that he doesn't, if I just throw him and he hits her and he hurts her, what kind of benevolent action am I running here? And if he gets hurt, or if somebody falls on him, again, what kind of, you know, what's my benevolent score? Should be pretty low. Put your aura of protection around you for this hour. Make sure nobody gets hurt. Look at everybody. Know where the teacher is at all times. Be totally aware. Nobody know who comes in and who leaves without looking at the door and without paying attention to who's watching. That's expand your awareness. That's how you can work on benevolence. One way, there are millions. But anyway, so let's do a technique. Jan, do shionage. Kata te tori shionage. Okay, now do it without the smile. Do it from closer in and do it a hell of a lot faster. Yeah, and it was sloppy. Very good. Excellent. Excellent. I'm not kidding you. Excellent. No, don't spoil it. Let me remember you just like you were. That was good. That second one was real. You were a little off balance. Great. Much more real and germane than... So, Shihonage, please, cut the tori. Please take another part. Okay, now, self-benevolence is also important. Leaving your foot out there. Somebody could trip over and hurt themselves, or somebody could be thrown and land on it, hurt the living hell out of you.
Right.
Keep that leg on me.
Thank you.
Yeah. That wasn't bad either. Yeah, exactly. That's your cross. You know? So lug that up the hill. Fuck right. Who cares? Sensei's watching. He doesn't care about the technique. He never taught technique. If he looked at you, he wouldn't notice your technique. I guarantee you, in 9 years of living with him, and you've heard me say this, I never once saw him teach a technique to anybody. In private, when there was nobody around, when he was working himself on his technique, or publicly to anybody. He did not look from that vantage point. And if you look from that vantage point, you know, then you love the eighth dance better than you love the six cues, you know? I mean, well, what is this? You know? What kind of bullshit is that? People are people are people are people are people, right? And you look how they train, how they take care of other people, whether they kick their shoes in the corner, you know? And if they always kick their shoes in the corner, maybe that's part of their personality. But anyway, you look at those things, and then you begin to build a picture of a person. But you don't look to whether you did shionage right. Yeah, but try not to wait for him like you know what's going to happen. Give her all you got. And don't smile. Go. Nail her. Yeah. Okay, great. 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 You came up with something. Fine. Great. Closer, 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 closer. No, you're not attacking him. You're still not attacking him. Look, here. Here. Yeah, all right. Right to his heart. Yeah. And nail him. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay, now, if it gets too rough and too out of control, you got to modulate. I'm not calling for anybody to get hurt by pushing. But you know your own edges, and you'll have to be responsible for who you're working with. But take it to 90%. Take it to 93%. Take it however high you can take it. All right? Just for an hour, and then you'll be done. That's a lovely sound. Maybe we could, I hope they recorded that. Okay, now, first of all, you're hooked about 8 feet deep in the soil. There is no reason for you to believe, just because the threat is apparent from this direction, that it's actually going to come from this direction. Okay?
Yeah.
So, you'd be ready for anything. So, this is either some theatrical pose, or you got some weird new kind of technique. But it's a lot of people do it automatically. Okay? You don't, next time you get in a hassle with a cab driver, I guarantee you're not going to be doing this, you know? Because you know what that means, you know? Meaningful things to him he can handle. But this, lady, what the hell are you doing with your hand out there? When we kiss your ring, what? You know? So functionally, it has no meaning. It's a cliche that gets attached to Aikido that is really counterproductive. So meet her as though you'd never seen her before.
So I don't know which side she's coming from.
You don't know which side, and you don't care.
And I'm not showing her which side to go
from. Absolutely. And okay. Nobody goes for the side. When it's real, baby, it's right here.
Yeah.
Right in your face, right? That's where it's at. It's coming right down here. And then you will determine what side it is. Which side you wish to go to. If there's a 1,000-foot cliff here, I have a feeling you'll be going on to this side. Right? Or whatever the configuration is. But a priori, you start a free child in space. Okay? And too often Aikido training gets us set in one dimension. We feel monstrously strong, and we are in this direction. But from any other direction, we're terribly weak. And it works against us. Yes, 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 good. 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 Very good. Yeah. Yeah, not sloppy enough, but you're working on it. Now kick it up a notch. Do it so he'll... Yeah, right. All right, it's getting level. It's getting nice and sloppy. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that's good, Elizabeth. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to do sumiotoshi. And this is, again, it works principally because of non-resistance. I didn't throw her down. Come on, nail me. Good. I gave her a little too much. Yeah. Try to understand me. I don't mean too much. Just enough to make me look good, right? Okay, so here's the blend. Here is where we agree. Thanks, but here, let's do it slow-mo. Grab, just do it from static, if you will. Static grab hold. Here's the blend. Here is my following her movement. Contrary to popular belief, I don't lead this, I follow. She's already moving backwards. She was kind enough to fall, but that's because she's an uke, and we're trying to work this thing out. But in point of fact, if I do it correctly, if I blend correctly, when I turn, she's already moving. Okay? It has in it, thanks to the elements, and I might as well use this since I brought it along. That's the trouble with bringing these things along. You have to use them. Because otherwise, why'd you bring it? You know? And I tell you, a whip is the most useless artifact invented by the human being. It has no purpose whatsoever. Really? None. What do you do with a whip? Huh? What? Whip slaves, yeah, okay. So next time you get a bunch, let me know, and we'll come and whip them. All right, so it's whip slaves or what? Scare tigers. Okay, so when you scare tigers, do you hit the tigers with a whip?
No.
No, you use the noise. So what you do is you attack air with this thing. Okay, it's a pretty useless thing, but it's very good. I think the only real use is it's good for investigating the principles of Aikido. Because let us consider what's essential to the operation of a whip. And I do hope we're all out of range here. Nancy, maybe, yeah, you could be the stalking horse, Nancy. Okay, so this thing works. Why? It works. It doesn't work very well because I get the strings wrapped up around itself. But please forgive me that. It works because it's soft. Okay? Any rigidity in this will hamper its utility, which is to break air molecules, which is why you hear the sound. I hope this will be all right. I hope the kids won't be scared by this. Sometimes the sound can be kind of loud. Okay? What that was a circle of decreasing radius, increasingly decreased radius, went down this whip until finally the tip of the whip was traveling so fast that it pushed the air molecules into each other and there was a rending of air, so to speak, and the sound barrier was broken, and that's what you heard. That's that loud sound. That happened again precisely and only because this thing is loose. Now notice, using it in this parameter, actually using it in any parameter, there's a lag time. There's a little bit of delay. I start the movement, and it takes some time for that circle to proceed out to the end and the whip to crack. Okay, in such a way here, in this movement, there's a little delay here. There's a little looseness and there's total looseness to start. Total freedom. Sorry, I'm getting close with that. Total non-resistance. And a slight delay in the turn back. It's very difficult to analyze, but it's a great throw to fool around with. Agree.
What?
Agree.
Agree.
Agree. Yeah. Well, always with me. For openers, but okay, yeah, you can agree with her. I mean, since you're working out.
That I wasn't really working.
No, you didn't agree with her at all. No, still. Yeah, you're ahead of her, and you're still dominating her. Yeah. See, if you can, with a relative beginner, see if you can get to a place of confusion where you're not, I blew this one. See if you can turn and be in so agreement with her that you don't know what to do. See if you can reach that place.
You know what I'm finding is difficult with since I injured my back to fully let go with that kind of abandon.
Uh-huh.
Totally freaks my back out.
Uh-huh.
And me.
Well, see if you can't modulate it. Or maybe you can't do that. Maybe that's wrong, like a wrong kind of movement. So then, see if you can, agree in other ways, See if, it's the feeling, it's the thing, rather than, if you can't do the movement, you can't do the movement. Then you throw the whole thing out, Oh, sensei can't move. I can't move now. So I do quit. It's a good excuse, but not if you're sincere about the art. So this may be a limitation that you're going to have to learn to live with. So work on getting the deeper quality of it and screw the movement. And maybe you'll figure out another way to adapt. You do a whole new kind of movement you never knew that you were going to find, you know? That's what I've found. There's grown to be a lot of cliches in Aikido. Just like in any art form, certain mannerisms creep into a style that, and it becomes mannered. Okay, people are locked into a certain way of doing things. This is particularly disadvantageous for us in this art, because this art must be ever present and ever ready to move in ways that you have no conception of. You have no idea when you will need this art for what. And so you must be free of these mannerisms. Nobody's entirely free of mannerisms, but we can begin to look at some of the mannerisms of Aikido and work against them. One of them, that's very good, but I was striking a pose. But thanks anyway, as long as you're here, stay. No, as long as you're here, we can use you. But don't hold me. What does this, the only time I've ever seen this used is when Queen Elizabeth I presents her ring to Lord Chesterfield to kiss, right? Other than that, I've never seen a living human being do this, except engage people who show each other their rings or something like that. But it is a gesture of very limited function, I assure you. Okay, disabuse yourself of this. And personally, it looks lousy. It just looks terrible. And what accompanies that cliche is usually this stance, which is the cheap power thrill, the closet power thrill of the week, right? Let's everybody stand here. Come on, let's get up and we'll get a power hit. Come on. No, not the ring yet. No, it's too powerful. It's too powerful. Let's just get a deep stance. And we can even, mentioning no names, lean forward and leer a little, right? Okay. And feel how powerful. Now, come on, get into your power. Feel how powerful this feels, okay? Yeah, right. Uh-huh. Okay, it's great. It's very powerful. And it's powerful, if you will, push on this. It's powerful from this dimension. You can withstand incredible volumes of force and drive, and two or three people could push, and we can make this into a big deal. But if she were to come around here and with her pinky, right in the center of my chest, extend slightly backwards, I'm gone. Ditto if she came behind me and did the same thing. I'm strong in hell up here. Right. I'm finished. It's an empty power hit. It is not powerful. You want to know powerful? Catch yourself when you're brushing your teeth, when you're browsing in a bookstore. Look where you're standing. That's your natural, normal stance. Relax your shoulders. Let your weight sink deep into the center of your body, into your hara. Let your arms and hands relax. Don't shake them loose. This is another cliche. If you got to do this to get loose, you ain't going to get loose. Loose is in your head, not in your muscles. If your head tells your muscles to relax, your muscles will relax. If you feel relaxed, you will be relaxed. So just let your hands hang down. Let your shoulders run. Don't worry about whether your belly sticks out, okay? Mine does a lot, and it hasn't hurt me at all. All right? Your power is here. Your power is in the connection that you feel in the ground. Your power is in your looseness, in your wit, and in your humor. Get stiff in the brain and try to produce humor. When somebody says, be funny, say something funny. Come on, come on. Right? You can't do it, right? That's because I got him uptight by that very question. What's this for, this thing? Why have we lapsed into this? We do it because we're showing people where we wish the energy to go. Right? But we are very subtle creatures. When we wish to announce our intention to be romantic or to get romantically involved with somebody, or we wish that they would reciprocate or whatever, We're very subtle. We don't go like that. Hopefully, we're much more subtle. You know, we're working on really delicate level. That's the level you got to work on if you're at all sincere about Aikido. That's why love and benevolence and all that stuff are so intertwined in this art. It's because your subtle energies get working. And so if you want to draw energy, what did I just tell you? Yeah, right. Do you feel me? Okay, so anyway, so that's one of the cliches. Okay, we worked on the time and space cliche. We worked on the ring kissers. All right, the last and most important one is multiple attack. I'm not going to do a multiple attack. I can't move very well, although that's no reason not to do it. But anyway, let me show you the cliche, Kathy. This is considered multiple attack. If you're out in the Mongolian steppes and you see 20 horsemen riding at you full speed with knives in their teeth and whips and guns, just tell yourself, it's okay, I got this. This will get me through anything, right? Because that's multiple attack, here they are, I'm home, right? Okay, forget about it, right? Just forget it, it's not gonna happen, right? This cliche, we must be rigorous in scrubbing out of multiple attack. We have to work on each person in a multiple attack appearing brand new. And we've got to force ourselves to move out of whatever seems comfortable and efficient for us and test ourselves in those areas. And one way is to do a different response every time you're attacked. You will probably mess it up quite a lot. 9 out of 10 ain't bad at all. Get used to missing. Don't get hooked on this success trip in Aikido. Success in here is meaningless. Success out there, in terms of responding appropriately in a situation of stress or conflict or difficulty, that's what we're after. Responding so that you can assist people and make other people's lives smoother, so you can make the person you live with or the people at home, so you can help them out better. That's first step. If that isn't working, forget this. You're not doing this right. If you do this right, it will help that. If you don't do that right, what meaning is it? It's just an academic, gymnastic, athletic skill. It ain't worth a powder to blow it to hell. And if that's all it was, I would not be here today. Believe me, O sensei, and I'll say this again, I say it a lot. O sensei, in my experience, in 9 years of studying with O sensei, I never saw him teach a technique to anybody, either in public or when everybody else had gone home and he wished to practice. He would call one of us, whoever was around, and he would get him to be an uke, usually with a sword or spear or something like that. He would never comment on the technique, not comment even, much less suggest you ought to do it this way. He did not look at people in Aikido, through the scrim of technique. He would notice if you were rough, if you were kind to those who were stronger than you, and thump those who were, you know, less experienced. He'd notice that. He'd notice the quality of your approach, but he didn't give a damn whether you did a good shihonage or a lousy shihonage, and if he did, I would have been out of there. I would have been released from this art. Because he didn't, I'm stuck with this thing. Okay? So I tell you, just keep working with your training. Do not criticize and get into your progress. There's too much instantaneous feedback. While I feel a sensing that I'm off a little, I think there's too much self-referencing for my particular taste immediately after the fact. Do 100,000 of them, then tell me how you feel about the technique. Is more, I think, the Japanese way of doing it. Not that I necessarily ascribe to that, and we should be perfectly happy to throw whatever they've developed out if it does not suit us. But it's pretty hard to deal with doing it over and over and over and over and refining it and getting it down. It's pretty hard to deal with that. So don't worry about your technique. Don't worry about it being sloppy. Is it real? Are you doing it with the best of heart, with the best of intentions? Are you matching your uke? If your uke is a young or an inexperienced person, are you whomping them? Or are you taking them just to a level where they can still deal with it without getting out of control? Are you pushing yourself up to a limit that you can handle? Not pushing yourself beyond it, but just pushing that envelope just a little. Are you kind to yourself about how your technique is going? Because if you're not kind to yourself, you're not going to be kind to other people. So you got to, I think, relax and be sloppy and not worry about it. Just keep working on it. It will come.
Home, my body, I have used it precious as a temple. Abused it, forgotten how to touch.
There's a picture of Terry that in some ways really kind of me embodies his spirit. And it's a picture of Terry sitting at a desk with O-sensei in a small library. It looks like a room with books around. And O-sensei is reading a book and Terry's reading a book and they're sitting across from each other. And it's not a training picture. It's not a on-the-mat picture. But somehow his relationship with O-sensei, or what O-sensei gave to Terry or allowed Terry to be or gave Terry permission to be, my feeling was there was this really deep love that Terry had for O-sensei, whether it was like a father-son, teacher-mentor, or whatever it was. And that became the basis of his own life. When I think about it, the two things that come to mind around Terry were that he was a pioneer. He was one of the first people to bring Aikido back to America after studying in Japan. He was one of the first people to bridge that cultural divide between Japan and America. And he was an innovator. He was one of the few people I know that gave himself full permission to do whatever he wanted, if long as he felt it would get the point across. And he would make things up, and which I loved about him. He would just make things up sometimes on the spot if he felt like that was going to work and that was going to get the person's experience that he wanted them to have.
He showed up at the dojo and Ohara-sensei, Yasuo Ohara, introduced him and as being an Uchi Deshi. So, yeah, it was neat. We're all waiting with bated breath to see this American Shodan out of Japan and how well he could perform and understood the arts of Aikido. And he walked into the dojo, this large young man, Terry tended the lumber, and he came in, and he was very open. Said hi to everybody, went into the dressing room, and we were all on the mat waiting, and he came out with his hakama. And as he bowed to the showman off the mat and everything, as he stepped on, he tripped on his hakama. And we said, yes, he's one of us. He laughed and kind of shrugged his shoulder and said, well, we're not all perfect yet. And that was my introduction to Terry Dobson. There was an open quality about Terry at this time that was just tremendous. There were no pretensions about him. No opinionations. In terms of the art, what he presented, what it meant to him, it was like an open book, his relationship with O-sensei, where he wanted to go, what he saw. And of course he was young. And so there was a boyishness in that quality too, that was just frankly, in my book, endearing.
You know, my first impression was he's a wild man, you know, but not out of control wild. There was just this big, hairy troll of a man dressed in a skirt. Because, you know, you look at, I'd never seen Aikido before, and there's this guy, with he's got the white keiko gi on, but he's got the hakama, you know, the pleated sort of trouser skirt that you wear, and just the contradiction there. And he had a kind of delight the way he was training, and it was right on the edge of an evil, nasty delight, because he was throwing people so hard, and yet they weren't getting hurt. It was like all the tension in their body was blowing out their pores, and then when he would be thrown, if the person was at all incautious in what they were doing, instead of him just sort of lying there and taking the fall, he'd be reaching up, grabbing for the balls or something like that. You know, just basically, you're always on, you never let your guard down. And he was having, and particularly that day, I remember, he was having so much fun.
I began formally training with adult classes after seeing Terry for the first time. He made me feel like I could train just as powerfully as any person ever could need to train. Though I was small, I know he always emphasized how size had nothing to do with what one could do when it came to resolving conflict. That women's hips were just as strong as men's hips, and that women's intention could be just as strong, if not stronger, than a man's. So his way of teaching was not about waza, was not about technique. He called himself a technician, a mechanic. But he really was more about the spirit of healing conflict and about recognizing how fragile we all were, how ephemeral everything was.
You know, I pack up my things, I go out to the seminar, and Terry's out there teaching, and he begins to talk about the bullwhip analogy. And he brings out his bullwhip, and he's smacking his bullwhip and making the thing crack. And everybody's looking at him, going, I don't know what's going on here. And so he looks the line of people sitting there and watching him. And he calls me up. And so, again, Terry doesn't really know me all that well. Maybe he recognizes my face from previous seminars. But he notices I have a long ponytail. Years ago when we had longer hair and more hair. So I walk up there and Terry says, grab my wrist. So I grab his wrist, and he moves his body so that the energy goes through my body and flips my ponytail up. And he was illustrating the same thing he was illustrating with the bullwhip, is that we've got to make our motion so that it goes through our partner and whips them like the end of a bullwhip. But he wanted my ponytail to illustrate that on a person. He made a statement that most people always feel that it's a detriment to have your back to the wall. Got my back to the wall. They backed me up against the wall. I didn't know what to do. And he says, I love to have my back to the wall. He goes, there's nobody that can sneak up behind me. So then we proceeded to spend another hour of the seminar doing ikkyo with our back against the wall.
One of my best memories, my earliest memories, was him asking me to attack him. And I had just come from Taekwondo, maybe a year ahead of that. I was a pretty good puncher. And so I kind of gave him a punch, you know, thinking this guy's huge, you know, I don't want to punch him. But he's got a nice big stomach. And he looked at me with rather a little bit of contempt. He said, come on, give it what you can. Give it all you got. What is this wussing around stuff, you know? So it ticked me off a little bit. I said, okay, all right, he wants it. So I put everything I had into it. And my fist got buried up to pass my knuckles in his stomach. And I was thinking, oh, no, I'm in such trouble. He looks down at it and he says, good punch. And he never flinched. His expression didn't say, it just did that. I was a lunge punch. I stayed in there. That's how come I know how far in it went. And years later, I asked him, I said, Terry, how come that punch didn't hurt you? And he said, because you didn't mean to hurt me. You had no intention of hurting me. And I went, whoa. I still puzzle over that. It seems to me people hurt each other without intent a lot. But that particular one, that was his answer to my punch, and I have no better one.
When we started the practice, because he was senior to me at that time, I had a chance to attack him first. And I did my, you know, four attacks. He did these beautiful, wonderful, sweet, loving, caring, kind of Santa Claus, teddy bear throws where you just felt like you were well taken care of and thrown. And then I kind of expected that when you attack, that would be the energy I would get. And it was totally different. It was like turning a light switch on and off. It was as if this killer had certainly appeared and he was after me with the intent to do me harm. And I remember the feeling of my body just kind of shuddering a little bit and shaking and thinking to himself, wow, I don't think I'm going to survive this. And this was after like the first instant. And then he proceeded to do these. I threw him. I moved him around. I don't remember what we were doing, the technique or anything. I remember getting him on the ground or letting me get him on the ground. And then he got back up and did this three more times. And then it was my turn again. And I imagined that somehow I was going to be attacking someone that was going to be so ferocious and meet my intensity with this kind of killer intensity that he had in that moment. And instead, what I met was that Santa Claus, teddy bear, loving compassion, open heart, generous field of energy that I that I had not expected when he did it. So we proceeded to go back and forth this way, where when he would attack, it was as if he was a different person than when he would defend. And I remember thinking to myself at the time and remembering this moment and thinking, you know, you don't always have to be really nice to be able to get the attack across, to be able to play that role. In fact, if you're too nice when you play that role, you take something away from your training partner. You actually pull some energy away from it.
My first vivid memory of Terry was he came at me, this huge lumbering bulk coming at me full speed, is what it felt like. And I probably weighed at the time 130 pounds, and I don't know, Terry was probably, what, 250, wow. 260 more, 280, I don't know at the time. And I remembered he grabbed my neck, pushed me up against the wall, and my feet were barely touching the mat, and he stepped on one of my feet high up in the ankle, and he said, do something! And I just made a little grunt, because he was, you know, had his hand around my neck. And it wasn't, the beauty of Terry is he definitely could be a frightening guy, but I knew, you know, there's an intimidation there, but it was appalling to me more by the fact that it was so out of context. I had never really done this in Aikido. This was a unique attack, you know.
Aikido has very formalized attacks, and you attack a certain way. And Terry was trying to break through that on some level, I think, and just show a range of possibilities in the street, or to unbalance you and see how you'd respond when you were under pressure. And also, I think for Aikido, you know, Terry was some level teaching how to do the impossible. And I think that's one of the beauties of Aikido is, can you do, one of the beautiful things about Aikido is we're trying to do something that maybe we don't have the physical ability to do, but we're trying to achieve it.
Terry couldn't have been a teacher in the traditional sense. His whole teaching technique was to say, you don't know what you think you know. I'm going to rattle your cage. You know, you think you're supposed to get off the line when there's an attack. No, you're supposed to stay on the line. You think that uke is supposed to fall beautifully. No, when you're doing good technique, uke is going to fall awkwardly.
And he also had this notion of that you shouldn't attract attention to you. If it's true Aikido, it shouldn't, part of not having beautiful Aikido is it shouldn't look like you know anything. He goes, oh, I beg your pardon. And he'd throw someone, oh, sorry, as if he said, can you do Aikido in a bar? Can you do Aikido when there's no space to move? Can you, you know, all these can you hypothetical situations that no one in a traditional Aikido class would ever imagine. And he wanted to make the Aikido look kind of sloppy, and uke had to take sloppy ukemi. There's no way of taking some beautiful fall because he was trying to conceal the fact that he knew anything.
Alexander was about to take his Shodan test, and he did a demonstration test for the dojo. And it was very, very precise and very high quality. And everybody was a bit in awe. And somebody said, Terry, what do you think? And Terry, who was not the teacher in the dojo, he was not the main instructor, he had a very ambiguous role there, stood up and he said, I know none of you want to hear this, but I think Alexander showed the Aikido of love. And the Aikido of love has no meaning without the Aikido of, and he said something like hate. I'm not sure exactly which word he used. But basically, if uke doesn't feel threatened, your Aikido is not going to be effective. And so you have to balance the Aikido of love with the Aikido of hate.
I was 16 years old, and there was this guy who had studied with O-sensei. And I made the decision I was going to learn everything I could from this guy. And we're there, and we're doing tenkan, just basic foot movement. And we do the tenkan, and I'm watching him, and I'm mathematically figuring out how he's moving. And he comes up to me afterwards, and he says, kid, you're freaking me out. Back off. He was very adamant about the concept of takimusu aiki, which was the Aikido of protection, and that Aikido should be used as a protective art rather than as a martial art. And the idea that having Aikido gave you the option of, you know, not breaking somebody's arm or not slamming them into the ground, the thing that was always clear was, okay, you get them down to the ground, now what do you do? And I remember taking classes where he said, okay, now you got them down to the ground, now talk to them. So the idea was, once you get them down to the ground, you're going to have to let them up, or you're going to stay there for the next 20 years. And then it became, okay, now when you're doing your technique, through your technique, communicate to your partner. Because if you can put them down on the ground without instilling fear in them, if you let them up, the chances of them wanting to get up and hurt you are less. So it was this whole communication thing. He really inspired me to look for different aspects of Aikido. You know, I had done the physical things, you know, I had done judo so I could throw somebody and I could hit somebody and all that kind of stuff, but it didn't allow me to be the person who I was or who I wanted to be. And Terry said, you know, the great thing about coming in the door of the dojo is, you know, on your first day, no one knows who you are. Mm-hmm. So you can become the person you always wanted to be. And when you become that person can leave the dojo. And that was always the thing that really struck me, is when we're in here, we have the opportunity to restructure who we are, how we want to address the universe.
The principle that he lived by at his best was what he believed he learned from Ueshiba Morihei, the founder of Aikido, that there is a way to live with other people which doesn't cause them either fear or oppression, and doesn't cause you to be fear, either in a state of fear or oppressed. that there's a place that people can actually live together in mutual respect and ensuring the dignity of each of you. And that was the principle he really struggled for. And at his best, that's where he got.
Terry, later in life, had gotten sick. And he told Ricky when he walked through the streets of New York that he felt vulnerable, that anybody could do anything to him. These are, you know, almost every person has felt fear like this. I think for Terry, this was a totally new feeling. Anyway, he was at our house. He was sitting on the hearth, and he said he understood now how women felt vulnerable on the street. And Jane said, "No, you don't." And then Terry said, "I'm sorry, I probably don't." And it was just such graceful little chemi. I thought he would resist. And he didn't. And, you know, for me, that just taught me that connection between, you know, you do Aikido and somebody attacks you 500 times or you attack somebody 500 times and you get thrown and you don't think anything of it. In fact, it was fun. But off the mat, when somebody attacks you, somebody throws you, or the feeling, it's the exact same resistance that beginners have. How somebody attacks them, somebody grabs them a rotatory, and their shoulders go up, they get tense.
He said, "You know, I was really sick. I'm walking down the street in New York. And boy, in New York, you better be able to read body language." And he said, "There were these characters on the street." And he said, "I realized I was really totally vulnerable." And within that statement and the way he presented, I began to see almost a return to what he had been when I first met him, or how I perceived him the first time I met him. And that was neat. It was sad when he finally died, but I really thought that in a very real sense, he had done a full 360 and was the person that I knew when I first met him.
He was always searching for, if Aikido is the answer, what is the question? What Terry taught was not technique. What he taught was intent and attitude, and that how that reflected in the body, and how when you move the body a certain way, that would come out. It's like you can't be angry and relaxed at the same time. And he was thinking on those terms, I think. So his intent was that of compassion and love. And so the question that I think he was searching for is, what is your intention? You know, during conflict, in a relationship, in daily life, what is your intention?